Happy morning, children. In today's class, we're going to continue with the lesson Federalism from Civics. Let's get started. Okay, the topic is Decentralization in India. We noted above that federal governments have two or more tiers of governments. We have so far discussed the two tiers of government in our country. But a vast country like India cannot be run only through these two tiers. States in India are as large as independent countries of Europe. In terms of population, Uttar Pradesh is bigger than Russia. Maharashtra is about as big as Germany. Okay, children, before getting into this topic, we'll first learn what is decentralization. So the meaning of decentralization is the practice of taking power away from the union and state governments and giving it to the local governments. So this is called decentralization. So you all know that in our country India, we have got union government, state government, right? So taking of power from union and state governments and giving it to the local governments or panchayats, it's called decentralization. So we have already discussed that we have got two tiers of government in our country, that is central government and the state government. But if you take a country like India, it's a large country, right? So it cannot be run by only the two tiers of government. So what should be done? It should be distributed, isn't it? Yes. So if you take states in India, they are large as in independent countries of Europe. Like in terms of population, Uttar Pradesh, it's a state in India. So it is bigger than Russia. And if you take Maharashtra, it is about as big as Germany. So Maharashtra is as big as Germany, and in terms of population, Uttar Pradesh is bigger than Russia. So if you can see, India is a large country, so it cannot be run by the central government or either the state government. So the power should be distributed among the local governments also. So we'll see about that in detail. Many of these states are internally very diverse. There is thus a need for power sharing within these states. Federal power sharing in India needs another tier of government below that of the state governments. This is the rationale for decentralization of power. Thus resulted a third tier of government called local government. So children, if you can see, many of our states in our country, they are internally very diverse, which means it is vast and they have different units and different places, right? So they need a power sharing within the states. So federal power sharing in India needs another tier of government. So as we have already seen, we have got two tiers of government, that is central and the state government. So now we need a third level of government because states in India are vast. So that the state third level of government is called local government. Okay, so decentralization is resulting in a different government called local government. Happy morning, children. In today's class, we're going to continue with the lesson Federalism from Civics. Let's get started. People have better knowledge of problems in their localities. They also have better ideas on where to spend money and how to manage things more efficiently. Besides, at the local level, it is possible for the people to directly participate in decision making. This helps to inculcate a habit of democratic participation. Local government is the best way to realize one important principle of democracy, namely local self-government. So if you take the local level, so people have better knowledge of their problems in their localities, and they are well known about the problems, and they have a better idea where to spend money and how to manage things more efficiently. So that is why third level of government is very important. And moreover, in the third level of government, people can directly participate in decision making. So this helps to inculcate a habit of democratic participation. And the local government is the best way to realize one important principle of democracy, that is local self-government. So local self-government. The need for decentralization was recognized in our constitution. Since then, there have been several attempts to decentralize power to the level of villages and towns. Panchayats in villages and municipalities in urban areas were set up in all the states, but these were directly under the control of state governments. There was a need for decentralization of government, and this was recognized in our constitution. So there was several attempts to decentralize the power to the level of villages and towns. So panchayats in villages and municipalities in urban areas. So if you take villages, you can have panchayats, and if you take urban areas, city areas, we could see municipalities. So all this are set up in all these states, and these are directly under the control of the state governments. So these panchayats, municipalities, which are set up in the states, are controlled by the state governments. Elections to these local governments were not held regularly. Local governments did not have any powers or resources of their own. Thus, there was very little decentralization in effective terms. A major step towards decentralization was taken in 1992. The constitution was amended to make the third tier of democracy more powerful and effective. So if you take the third level of government, that is the local governments, so the elections in the local governments were not held regularly, and they do not possess any power or resources of their own. So we could come to know that there was very little decentralization in effective terms. So a major step was taken in the year 1992 in order to make decentralization more powerful. The constitution was amended to make the third tier of democracy more powerful and effective. So the third level of government, that is the local government, it was amended to make the third tier of democracy more powerful and effective. Now, it is constitutionally mandatory to hold regular elections to local government bodies. Seats are reserved in the elected bodies, and the executive heads of these institutions, the scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and other backward classes. At least 1/3 of all positions are reserved for women. Here we could see some of the amendments by the constitution with respect to the decentralization to be more powerful. So the first point is, now it is constitutionally mandatory to hold regular elections to local government bodies. So now each and every local body should hold the regular elections. The second point is, seats are reserved in the elected bodies, and the executive heads of these institutions for the scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and other backward classes. So seats are reserved for all these classes. And the third point is, at least 1/3 of all positions are reserved for women. So here they are giving importance for women also. 1/3 of all positions should be reserved for women. An independent institution called the State Election Commission has been created in each state to conduct panchayat and municipal elections. The state governments are required to share some powers and revenue with local government bodies. The nature of sharing varies from state to state. So the fourth point is, an independent institution called the State Election Commission. So it has been created in each and every state to conduct panchayat and municipal elections. So that is the fourth point, an independent institution called the State Election Commission has been created in each and every state to conduct panchayat and municipal elections. And the last point is, the state governments are required to share some powers and revenue with local government bodies. The nature of sharing varies from state to state. So if you take, every state government should share some powers and revenue, money, with the local government bodies. And the nature of sharing, it varies from state to state. Rural local government is popularly known by the name Panchayati Raj. Each village or a group of villages in some states has a Gram Panchayat. This is a council consisting of several ward members, often called panch, and a president or sarpanch. They are directly elected by all the adult population living in that ward or village. It is the decision-making body for the entire village. If you take the rural local government, so which is located in village sites, so rural local government is popularly known by the name Panchayati Raj. So rural local government is known as Panchayati Raj, and each village or a group of villages in some states has a Gram Panchayat. Okay, so if you take any village, they have a Gram Panchayat, and this is a council consisting of several ward members, often called panch, and a president or sarpanch. So in each council there will be several ward members, so these ward members are called as panch, and a president for that ward is called as a president or sarpanch, and they are directly elected by the adult population overall living in that ward or that village. So it is the decision making body for the entire village. So the Panchayat Raj is the decision making for the entire village. The Panchayat works under the overall supervision of the Gram Sabha, all the voters in the village or its members. It has to meet at least twice or thrice in a year to approve the annual budget of the Gram Panchayat and to review the performance of the Gram Panchayat. The local government structure goes right up to the district level. A few Gram Panchayats are grouped together to form what is usually called a Panchayat Samiti or block or mandal. The members of this representative body are elected by all the Panchayat members in that area. All the Panchayat Samitis or mandals in a district together constitute the Zilla District Parishad. Most members of the Zilla Parishad are elected. So the local government structure, it goes up to the next level, that is the district level. So what makes the district level? A few Gram Panchayats are grouped together in order to form a Panchayat Samiti or block or mandal. So it has got three names: Panchayat Samiti, block or mandal. And the members of this representative body are elected by all the panchayat members presented in that area, and all the panchayat samitis or mandals in a district together, they constitute the zilla, which is said to be district parishad. Okay, and most members of the zilla parishad are elected. Members of the Lok Sabha and MLAs of that district and some other officials of other district level bodies are also its members. Zilla Parishad chairperson is the political head of the Zilla Parishad. Similarly, local government bodies exist for urban areas as well. Municipalities are set up in towns. Big cities are constituted into municipal corporations. Both municipalities and municipal corporations are controlled by elected bodies consisting of people's representatives. Municipal chairperson is the political head of the municipality. In a municipal corporation, such an officer is called the mayor. If you see Zilla Parishad, so members of the Lok Sabha and the MLAs of that particular district and some other officials of other district level bodies are the members. Okay, and the Zilla Parishad chairperson is the political head of the Zilla Parishad. The chairperson is the head of the Zilla Parishad, and as how we have a local body, a local government in the for the rural areas, that is village areas, we also have it for the urban side. Okay, similarly, local government bodies exist for urban areas as well. So there it is called municipalities. So municipalities are set up in towns, okay, and big cities are constituted into municipal corporations. Both municipalities and municipal corporations are controlled by elected bodies consisting of people's representatives. So those people have elected, they will be constituting the municipal corporations, and municipal chairperson is the head of the municipality, And in a municipal corporation, the officer, we call it as the mayor. This new system of local government is the largest experiment in democracy conducted anywhere in the world. There are now about 36 lakh elected representatives in the panchayats and municipalities, etc., all over the country. This number is bigger than the population of many countries in the world. Constitutional status for local governments has helped to deepen democracy in our country. So if you take the local government bodies, the system of local government is the largest experiment in democracy, okay, which has been conducted anywhere in the world. And for now we have about 36 lakh elected representatives in the panchayats and the municipalities, and it is all over the country. And this number is bigger than the population of many countries in the world. And the constitutional status for local government has helped to deepen democracy in our country. So it has helped us to enrich democracy in our country. It has also increased women's representation and voice in our democracy. At the same time, there are many difficulties. While elections are held regularly and enthusiastically, Gram Sabhas are not held regularly. Most state governments have not transferred significant powers to the local governments, nor have they given adequate resources. We are thus still a long way from realizing the ideal of self-government. You see that this has also increased the women's representation and their voice in our democracy, and their more of women's participation. And at the same time, there are many difficulties. So we have also got positivity on one side. On the other side, we have got some difficulties. So while elections are held regularly and enthusiastically, Gram Sabha are not held regularly. So elections are held regularly, but Gram Sabhas are not held regularly. And most state governments, they have transferred significant powers to the local governments. So the state governments, most of the state governments in our country, they have transferred their power to the local government, nor have they given adequate resources. They have given the powers but not the resources. So we are still working along to make it or realize the ideal of self-government. The next topic, an experiment in Brazil. So Brazil has conducted an experiment regarding their government. We shall see what it is. A city called Porto Alegre in Brazil has carried out an extraordinary experiment in combining decentralization with participative democracy. The city has set up a parallel organization operating alongside the municipal council, enabling local inhabitants to take real decisions for their city. The nearly 13 lakh people in the city get to participate in making the budget for their own city. The city is divided into many sectors, or what we call wards. Each sector has a meeting, like that of the Gram Sabha, in which anyone living in that area can participate. There are some meetings to discuss issues that affect the entire city. Any citizen of the city can participate in those meetings. The budget of the city is discussed in these meetings. The proposals are put to the municipality that takes a final decision about it. About 20,000 people participate in this decision-making exercise every year. This method has ensured that the money cannot be spent only for the benefit of the colonies where rich people live. Buses now run to the poor colonies, and builders cannot evict slum dwellers without resettling them. In our own country, a similar experiment has taken place in some areas in Kerala. Ordinary people have participated in making a plan for the development of their locality. So here you could see an experiment which was conducted by the country Brazil. So a city called Porto Alegre in the country Brazil, it has carried out an extraordinary experiment in combining decentralization with participative democracy. So they wanted each and every citizens of their locality to participate in decision making and all. So the city has set up a parallel organization operating alongside the municipal council, enabling local inhabitants to take real decisions for the city. So they were enabling the local inhabitants, means the people who are all living, to take part in decision making. The nearly 13 lakh people in the city get to participate in making the budget for their own city. So can you believe, the 13 lakh people who are all living in the city, they get a chance to participate in making the budget for their own city. The city is divided into many sectors, or as how we call it as wards. Okay, it has been divided at many sectors or wards. Each sector has a meeting like that of the Gram Sabha, in which anyone living in that area can participate, and there are some meetings to discuss issues that affect the entire city. So there are some issues which affect the entire city, right? So for that also they have meetings, and any citizen of that city can participate in those meetings. And about 20,000 people participate in this decision making exercise every year. And this method has ensured that the money cannot be spent only for the benefit of the poor, I mean benefit of the rich people or the rich colonies. It should also be given to the poor people. So buses now run to the poor colonies, and builders cannot evict slum dwellers without resettling them. Even in our own country, a similar experiment was taken place, that is Kerala. So in our country, a state called Kerala, it has experimented this. So ordinary people have participated in making a plan for the development of their locality. Okay children, we have completed the lesson Federalism from Civics. So I have given you the keynotes in the PDF. So the remaining keynotes, you have to write it neatly in your classwork notebook. Okay children, thank you. We shall see in the next class with a new chapter.